A very good morning. Honorable Chancellor, Dr. P.D. Patel, Dr. Sri Bandarji, the Senior Professor of Medicine at Essence College, Jaipur, Dr. N.J. Pawar, sir, Dr. Surika, heads of the institutions, their faculty members, students, and awardees. Teacher's Day has been started around about in 19th century for the world. At different places, it has been started with the different ideas to recognize the local educator, to recognize the milestones in that country as far as education is concerned. In China, it's celebrated on 10th of September, World Teacher's Day, or what we call as International Teacher's Day, is celebrated on 10th of October. Most of these Teacher's Days are the world are being celebrated during August, September, October, because the starting of a new academic session in each of the universities, colleges, and other things. Here, as Priya already said, we know everybody that this Teacher's Day is being celebrated on 5th September as a birthday of Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. The recognition of the Teacher's Day is basically to recognize the contribution of the teachers. It marks the point that our younger generation remembers the contribution which the teachers have done. And on this beautiful occasion, on behalf of the DPU, on my personal behalf, I wish heartiest congratulations to all the teachers, because the credits and contribution of the DPU is to maximum extent based on the teachers of here. So once again, I congratulate the teachers today. Teachers have to be a role models, aren't they? I remember some of the instances, because this is the only profession in which you will like to see your student to be better than you. You will be proud if your student is much better positioned than you. I remember a very interesting example. I think it was in 1991-92. I was moving on to Saurabhnagar in the Delhi market. Abruptly, there was a traffic going on. The police was there, and one flag hosting car was going on. Abruptly stopped before me, and person came out, and four gunmen surrounded him and to me also. I was surprised. He was the deputy commissioner of the Delhi, who has been my student in 83 at Himachal. And of course, believe me, I was not able to recognize him, because the students, particularly from the tribal areas of Himachal, and now coming as the IAS and then coming in the as the deputy commissioner of the Delhi, the personality was different, everything was. And he bowed, and the way he, sir, I am the student, because I remember what you taught me at that time, that made me to go for the administrative training. That's why the role of the students for the teachers, the respect of the teachers is in their hearts. However, my dear teachers, situation has changed during the last 30 to 40 years. Initially, it was the teaching which was responsible. From the teaching, it moved to the learning aspects. But now it has gone a step higher. With the global competition, we have a tremendous potential, particularly in India, for producing highly educated and large number of educated teachers. We need highly professional expertise to compete in the global market. For that, the students have to be skilled trained. And it is the teachers, we teachers, who have to ensure that they are well trained and have a practical knowledge. Our teachers at DPU have always been a step ahead in providing the excellent learning curriculum, in providing the teaching in the applied aspects. It's on this basis that DPU every year recognizes three teachers for their contribution as a researcher, number one, number two, as an innovative teacher, and last, not a young researcher, the award being made on the name of Dr. P.D. Patel. So, sir, I will share with you that we pay 80,000 rupees to the three teachers as an award on this day. The selection, maybe some of the faculty may not be known, the selection of these three people has been done purely by the people who have been outside of the Vidya Peeth. We ensure this year that nobody from the Vidya Peeth, any college, will be associated with the selection of these three teachers. So those three teachers, I congratulate the three teachers who are here for achieving the awards on this day. And the contribution for teachers? Teachers' contribution is not practical until unless the students' outcome is there. That's why, on the basis of the learning outcomes, which the students have been able to gain due to teaching of the teachers. Today we are giving the 18 awards to the meritorious students who have achieved excellence in their own courses, and each of these students will be getting 5,000 rupees award plus their certificate of merit. All these contributions have made loans to the DPU. It's because of these infrastructure, international curriculum, highly reputed faculties that UGC has awarded us a category of grade one deemed universities. Throughout India, there are only 9 or 10 deemed universities which have been given, put on the category one, and we are luckily one of those universities which are under the grade. We have a CGPA of 3.62, which is highest to any of the universities which have been provided them on the basis of for the health science university. We were accredited in 2015. Till now, nobody except Ramchandra, which also had a 3.62, no other university who are imparting health science education have been able to type the figure of 3.62. That speaks that. We have been trying to maintain the curriculum, and for that, the credit goes to our Honorable Chancellor, who has been source of inspiration to all of us regarding the, whether it is the infrastructure, whether it is the teaching learning, name any facilities we ask from him. It is within 1 minute. He can say a number of questions for other things, but when it comes to the finances for any positive initiative, there's never no from him. That is the reason why we people are here. Let the onset come, thank the chief guestway, an eminent personality in his own field. He has reached here at midnight at 12:30. And he is here with us, and immediately after this function, he is returning back. Sir, I am highly grateful that you could spare your valuable time to be with us and to interact with our students and faculties and give your message about the how we can move forward. Once again, on behalf of DPU, I wish the teachers an excellent year to have. I congratulate the teaching awardees. I congratulate the young students, those who have been awarded. Maintain this award and have a competition with others. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you, sir. Now we have the research award for the year 2018. I would like to introduce you Dr. Nilesh Sharma, who is a PhD graduate from IIT Roorkee and trained in cancer cell biology and NIH and Rutgers University Medical School, USA. Currently, Dr. Sharma is an associate professor at the Biotechnology Institute of Dr. V.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth and working in the area of cancer cell biology and therapeutics. Dr. Sharma is credited with more than 40 international peer-reviewed scientific publications. He receives DPU Research Award for the year 2018, a cash prize of ₹40,000. I request Chief Guest Dr. Sudhir Bhandari, Honorable Chancellor Sir, Vice Chancellor Sir, to felicitate Dr. Nilesh Sharma. Young Researcher Award for the year 2018, Dr. Gargi Sarode. Dr. Gargi Sarode works as Associate Prof, PG and PhD Guide in the Department of Oral Pathology and Microbiology. She has around 160 national and international publications to her credit, with 441 citations and filed 2 patents successfully. She has received the Best Faculty Award, Young Scientist Award, Most Promising Young Educationist Award.
We are giving another category of awards, that is Innovative Teachers Award. Teachers can change life with just the right mix of chalk and challenges. I request Dr. Vaishali Bhanambe, who is a professor, Department of Anatomy, Dr. Vaishali Bhanambe, Medical College and Hospital. She has worked in Vaishali Bhanambe Medical College for the last 22 years. She has 34 publications to her credit and she recently completed her PhD in topic related to organ donation. She has used innovative methods of teaching the subject of medical embryology.
Moving on to the class toppers, the Student Achievement Awards, Faculty Course MBBS, First Year Qureshi Samreen, Second Year MBBS Sabha Chaudhary, Third Year MBBS Ashta Jain. And Priyanka Sridhar. Branch of Optometry, First Year. Sai Priya, Second Year. Rajesh Bhumika, Third Year. Shreya Tandokar, Dentistry, First Year Akriti Pandey, Second Year Madhulika Singh, Third Year Akriti. biotechnology, first year Simi Singh, second year Naveen Vinod, third year Ananya Sharma. Branch of M.Tech, Dhanashri, first year, second year Simran Singh, third year Prajakta.
Still near hanging on with the same
So the branch of biotechnology, Pradnya Prasanna, first year, second year Hina Purana, third year Shamika. Chandni of second year, Bhavna of third year. From the branch of MBA, first year Priya Tripathi, from the branch of BSc Nursing, Rachel, first year, Pramod Misal, second year, Elsa, third year.
It is indeed an honor to request our visionary leader, our mentor of mentees, Honorable Chancellor Sir, Dr. P.D. Patil Sir, to address the gathering.
I would like to welcome our chief guest, Dr. Sudhir Bhandari ji, whom I met at Jaipur and requested him to visit our university, and he has graciously accepted our invitation. and as the chief guest for this program. Sir, I would like to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule, and I welcome you to the Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth Pune. Dr. Razdan, he is the Vice Chancellor of our university. Dr. N.B. Pawar will be next Vice Chancellor of our university. Dr. Suryakar, Raishar of this university. I also welcome other dignitaries, faculty members, staff, and my dear students. Today, really, I'm very happy to welcome you all for this great function for the Teachers' Day. I remember last 35 years when I started this institution. This institution started by Honorable Dr. D.Y. Patil. In 1984, 29 March 1984, he has given me Order of Rajistar. And then I have started my career as a Rajistar, as a storekeeper, as an accountant and builder. He has given me the responsibility of the builder also, because he's talked to me and you know, you must do it, the construction also. From that, last 35 years, I'm working day and night. So I know what are the problems of the teacher. From the basically, when we have started the engineering college, we are not getting the staff also. I go to the government college, engineering college. That time I got a scooter. I go there. I discuss with them. They talk to me very arrogantly. And they told me, what do you have? Why you are starting this such college? You don't have a facility also. Can you create the facility? Then I requested them, sir, please come. We'll start the work and I will do the facilities. I will erect the infrastructure also. That time nobody believes they can create, we can do it. But anyway, it's my luck, it's a God blessings. The staff has started to come from Government Engineering College. And after that, once Dr. D.Y. Patil Sahab has given me authority of the construction of this building, then I have started taking the interest. When I go to abroad, I see all the institutions, I see all the facilities, and after that my mind works. When I started engineering college, that time I have started giving the facility to our staff also. And I tell you, I am very proud. That time, first time, I have given the cabins to the HODs. That time our director, Kodu, was there. He started blaming to me. He told me, P.D. Patil is doing the mistakes. Once we do the cabins, now the politics will start. He don't know the teachers. What will happen? They will come together and they will start against the management. But I have not heard about them. Oh, I am doing my work sincerely. And 1984 to 1994, there was only one engineering college. Because of problems, nobody is supporting me to start the other colleges also. They are saying it is a white elephant. Don't do like this. You will get in problems. And because of you, Dr. Deepavati will come in, that's the problem. But after 1994, he has given me full authority. And after that, in 1994 only, I have started 10 colleges in 1 year. And you will be surprised to know, in one building where I am sitting there, the 10 colleges are working there in one building. And how I work, I don't know, because of God's blessings. Every hour, every minute, 10 principals are troubling me so much, I can't sit in the chair. Sir, there is no facility. Sir, there is no classroom. How to share? How you will work? Really, this is torturing 6 to 7 years. Really bad for me. Then I have taken a decision. What happened? I lived with students. If you don't have a financial support, you can't do anything. It is never possible, this dream. First, you have to think about the finance. And that's why, when one engineering college was there, only 240 intake was there. Income is very less. It is hardly to pay the bank, what do you call that, loan. And interest also. And 1992, what happened? There is no money with me to give the salary to the staff also. And that time, what I had done, I sold my steel, whatever in the site was steel was there, and cement, extra, it is there. So I sold and I paid the salary. But after 1994, God bless me, 10 colleges I have started, but I have taken the pressure of this teaching staff. That's okay. I have to play with them. Each and every hour I am playing with them. Don't worry, sir, you take Thursday holiday, you take Saturday holiday, we'll adjust your lectures to the other day. We'll start our college from morning 7 to evening 7. That day, that time, I have adjusted like that. And our principals are very happy. They are getting holiday. Sir, today is not possible. Okay, take holiday. Because I had to collect the finance. There is no choice at all. I can't fight with them. But why I am telling you? Once I have started, I know the teacher's problems. From basically, what facility we have to provide? What facility we have to provide to the students? Otherwise, we can't make the best college in India. And that basic things, I know it. That's why now you can ask any principal. I take him only 2 minutes. What you want, I will give it to you. And you know our 2,000-bedded hospital, you know the dental college, you know Ayurvedic college, homeopathic college, physiotherapy college, all the colleges. Everything best. In all over the world, I am trying to provide them. And anybody can challenge me, sir, we don't have this facility. The way I have constructed, around about 35 lakh square foot, the CEO, the quality, Last 10 years, I am working for the hospital. So many changes I have made in the hospital. So many changes. You can't believe it. 3 to 4 architects have worked there. They have done the work like government hospitals. All these black rooms and everything. I told them this is not going to be accepted by anyone, myself. So we have changed. And you are now seeing all the facilities. Today I am happy, sir, because of sir has seen all the facilities. And today, Honorable Vice Chancellor told you, we are the best in India. In ranking, in NDA marking, 3.62. So last 35 years, I am very happy what I have done for the students, for the teachers. I have given the best. Nobody can blame the institution. Management. And next, also, I wanted to do the international collaborations. And in that connection, I started my work also. And one work is there left in the hospital also, that is the cancer treatment. And after 3-4 months, once I have completed this hospital, I will start that work also. Means you will get all the facilities in hospital. Now we are giving the facility for the hospital that cancer patients, but that is half, means that is not the full treatment. But the best of the best equipments I want to purchase and I want to do the treatments. Till today, we are giving the treatment free food, because in 1996, one of my friends from Delhi, he told me, P.D. Patil, if you want to run the hospital, you have to give the free food, free medicines, otherwise it is very difficult to run the hospital. And today he is saluting me, P.D. Patil, you are in the best college. He is the MCI, the top man. Thank you very much. I will start read because I never give the lecture in the last 35 years. I only work. I am really, what do you call, workaholic. I never believe in this, reading these books and what do you call, lectures. Well, once I view the facility, then I can talk, otherwise there is no use at all. If I will show you the big a dream, and I will not give anything to you in a hand, you will blame me. He is a Pandalpal. So I have given. Today I am very happy. And you will see that in the next 10 years, it will be a very, very, very different institution. Let me read out to you a quote by Malala Yousafzai. One child, one teacher, one pen and one book can change the world. Rightly so, teachers are the first guiding step in this big world. Without a teacher, who is a guide to distinguish right from wrong, we will all be bodies without spirit. While growing up, the only person we tend to respect after our parents are our teachers, because the greatest lessons are learned in the classroom. And everything starts coming into practically, and hence our lessons come to life. Teachers may not always be confined to the four walls. They may come in the form of your parents, friends, or simply companion. Making your teacher feel specially may be a struggle for you, and hence, on this Teacher's Day, let me read out a line from the speech of our late President, Honorable Sri A.P.G. Abdul Kalam ji. In one of his very significant speeches during his tenure as the President of India, quoted in the speech that if a country is to be corruption-free and become a nation of beautiful minds, I strongly feel there are three key societal members who can make a difference. They are the father, the mother, and the teacher. I would now like to make a point for our teachers present here that they should keep working hard in the unlearning and then relearning again. As with the changing times, the changing world, technology, and scenario, it is very important that they keep updating themselves. I feel really proud that we here at Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth have our strength, and that is our teachers. Our faculty members who selflessly, with their dedication, hardship, and efforts, give this country the best of its future, which is you, my students. Without taking any more time, I congratulate all the students and our faculty members who are getting awarded here today for all their efforts, and I'm sure they do have a bright future and a long way to go. Thank you. Wish you all the best.
For sharing your views and inspiring us. I'll now like to introduce the chief guest for today, Dr. Sudhir Bhandari. I'm privileged to introduce Dr. Sudhir Bhandari, who's a senior professor of medicine at SMS Medical College and Hospital, Jaipur. He's a renowned physician and diabetologist and fellow of Royal College of Physicians, London and Edinburgh. He is governor's nominee to Board of Management of Rajasthan University of Health Sciences. He was bestowed with Rotary Foundation Fellowship in Diabetes and Metabolic Diseases as Cardiff and has been awarded Fellowship of American College of Endocrinology, Fellowship of American College of Physicians, Fellowship of Indian College of Physicians, Fellowship of Diabetes in India. Dr. Bhandari has published 70 articles in prestigious medical journals and contributed chapters for the textbook on hypertension, diabetes, and cardiovascular disorders. He has delivered guest lectures in 30 countries in various international conferences and more than 150 guest lectures at national level conferences. He is a brand ambassador of program known as Awareness for Life. Recently, Dr. Bhandari has been bestowed with World Icon Award at Bangkok on 9th June for his outstanding medical performance. Happiest congratulations, sir. Some of the other awards received by Dr. Bhandari includes Dr. P.J. Mehta Young Scientist Award, Dr. Chinna Reddy Gold Medal 3 times for Best Scientific Paper, State Merit Award by Government of Rajasthan, Best Physician Award by HEO Governor of Rajasthan, Times of India Award of Excellence and Pride of Rajasthan Award. Dr. Bhandari has also unique distinction of being honorary physician to HE Excellency, the governors of Rajasthan and all chief ministers for the last 20 years. We welcome you, sir, to our institution and kindly request you to share your views.
And all the other esteemed people sitting on the dais and faculty members. At the onset, I express my profound thanks, gratitude. I am humbled and touched by a warm invitation of Dr. P.D. And Patel, whom I admire as a great human being. I am so touched to be here, and I am honored to be here. And at the onset, I must tell you, sir, you spoke about your institute. I would say you spoke in very lesser words. I get a chance to travel extensively, and I must submit to you that you have created a world-class institute. It has been such a wonderful to see such wonderful equipments, such wonderful departments, such wonderful infrastructure that speaks of your vision. And I must tell you, there's a lot of difference between India 15 years before and now. We are at par with the rest of the world for equipment, infrastructure, and we have a very strong plus point which rest of the world doesn't have, is a human factor. So human touch, humanity, and human behavior of Indian doctors, along with the world-class infrastructure, takes you to a world-class height, sir. I'm so impressed, I'm so touched. Fortunately, I'm closely involved with one of the world-class center coming up in Jaipur, especially in collaboration with the LISPAN, world-class cancer center. I was so impressed to see some parts of your hospital that I told Dr. Patel that I'm going to bring our CM, Vasundhara Ji, who is also very innovative, with whom I'm closely working for creation of that hospital, to come and show your institute, sir. Now, at the same time, I must tell you that today is a very unique day, the Teachers' Day. And we have also been a student. We are still a student, and we are also dealing with the students. So Teachers' Day is a very interesting Teachers' Day. And if you look at this, it has been celebrated on the birth anniversary of Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who was more popular as a teacher than President of India. He was philosopher, he was humanitarian, he was intellectual, and he was a great soul. So look at this, that he was more popular on his strength of a teacher than the President of India, and we owe that how important it is nice to be a teacher. This is very important that, look, you should never give up. You should never be upset. The life is a very circuitous road. If you recollect that Abraham Lincoln, before getting nominated as a President of India, America, he lost 18 elections. Dr. Radhakrishnan was nominated for Nobel Prize 11 times, but he couldn't make it. But he got the Bharat Ratna and King's Knighthood. So you should never give up, never get upset. The God has destined what to be given to you and what not to be given to you. It is wonderful to be interactive, wonderful to be a teacher of grace and dignity. You should bring down to virtues to the students. During Maurya dynasty also, if you know little history, why I'm giving the example of little history, because I qualified civil services with the history and geology. I got my state cadre of IAS, but I didn't join and went to India. So during Maurya dynasty, the Chanakya said, no country can develop as a better nation unless they are good teachers. So look, since that back, the teachers are being so much respected and so much dignified. And it is a sense of pride and privilege that we are professionals, we are teachers, and we are going to be the great examples for our students. The best teacher teach by knowledge, teach by heart, and teach by their compassion. Teachers are the second parents. They decide our line of action, they decide our future, and they decide what is going to be our character. Teachers are like bringing all bricks together, and they make a building. Teachers are like a mason who is bringing the brick by brick together and making such a huge building of a nation, and hence they are the most integral part of what we are today. A person with positive attitude, which also develops with a teacher, cannot be stopped. A person with negative attitude cannot be helped. And bringing about this positive attitude in all the students, it is a responsibility of teachers. And this is very important. Acquiring knowledge is a fact. Assimilating of knowledge is an understanding. But proper application of facts and knowledge, which is brought about by blessings of the teacher is the wisdom. So we acquire knowledge, we acquire understanding, but to bring them into reality, I think we require a guru or teacher, which is very essential. And idea, this does not happen unless it is practiced. Unless we work on idea, it dies. And it is always important to work on ideas with the help of guidance and teacher. This is the very important part. Whenever we plan any educational endeavor, whenever we plan anything professional, we aim at success. When I join a course, I would look for a success. And the success is one which does not happen spontaneously. You need to be very sincere. We need to be very diligent. And diligence is an integral part of the success. Special skills, the formal education, or super intelligence, success never comes to them. It has to be coupled up with the diligence, sincerity, and commitment. Just by being super intelligent or just by being super qualified, it doesn't. You have to couple up with the sincerity and diligence, and this brings about the success in reality. Success is neither a miracle or a mystery, but it has to be earned. It is a natural outcome which comes with a consistent effort. So one of the messages which I like to give to my junior boys and girls, that consistency is very important, and hence you need to be very consistent to be successful. I always keep giving example to my PG students. You put your car in the full fastest gear. You are so intense in the last 2 months of pre-examination. But if you look at the examination paper, it is only the 25% is covered for what you have read in the last 2 months. Your consistent acclimatization to the subject and hard work will make you solve the whole paper. So I think the consistency is much more important to be successful. The difference between success and failure is just your degree of commitment. Like, there's not much difference in success and failure. The commitment is very important, and I think you all are so mature that commitment should be the integral part of what you're looking forward in life. Now, whenever we work for a educational qualification, I think we need to couple up this education with the self-discipline and humility. If you don't couple up education with self-discipline and humility, you're not learned. And if you look at the tree of your success, when you try to achieve some academic qualification, the next step you look forward for a good health, good wealth, good human relationship. Wealth is not an ultimate or the final factor, but it is very important to sustain respectfully and reasonably. Health is also very important. These days, we in our country are facing the new health challenges, and that's the reason you as a student has to be very careful from day one. You know, when we got independence, India has the issues of malnutrition, undernutrition, famine, and poverty. Can you believe in just 80 years, we have shifted from undernutrition to problems of lifestyle diseases with obesity almost 30 to 40%, the diabetes being 20%, with the hidden diabetic another 15%, the high incidence of hypertension to 35 to 40% in same ISD. And look at this. The biggest challenge has been shifting from infectious and the nutritional diseases to the problem of overweight and obesity, the professional and lifestyle diseases, and there's a shift of these to third and fourth decade. So along with being a wonderful students, along with the academic qualification, you need to be very careful about health aspect also, because of changing pattern of the lifestyle disease in our country, which is coming to the third and fourth decade, which is very important. All the health and wealth without a good relationship makes you emotionally bankrupt. So if you are healthy, you are well-read, very intellectual, but your human-to-human relationship is poor, you don't maintain a good human relationship, you will be emotionally bankrupt. The need of a good human relationship is the most important in medical profession. One of the things which I keep talking to my residents, the first thing which I have or expectation for a resident is never to lose patience. I tell them 100 into 0 is 0. He tells me, sir, I told him 5 times and 10 times he's asking me the same question. I keep telling my all the residents and medical students, suppose your grandfather gets admitted in a hospital, you are not a doctor with medical background, you are not aware of ABCD, you would expect sister to be polite, resident to be polite, consultant to be polite, all your grievances should be sorted out. All your questions should be answered. He says, yes, sir, I will expect my grandfather to be all right and sort it out. Then I said, what whom you are attending is also someone's grandfather. So I think the need of a good human relationship, need of a good human being and humility, I think is the highest required in our profession. And I'm sure this is the one which makes Indian doctors to score over the rest of the world. We are so touched, so impressed. Recently, I was called to Houston. There's an Indian Association of American Doctors for an oration. While being in the conference, my phone, I was answering some text messages. And they were taken aback that, look, anyone in India can reach to a consultant which is unheard world over. And that is the strength of all of us, and that is the strength of the good human being we have. Another important thing is that all the young students who got the award, you look forward for success in life. It is your right, it is the desire, but our objective is to sustain success and eliminate failure. Never be upset by it. There are some failures in life. One cannot achieve success without preparation and hard work. So never try to find a shortcut. You have to consciously satisfy yourself that you acquired enough knowledge. You may get good marks, but without adequate knowledge. You need to be well-read, well-educated. If you want to stand out, you need to do something outstanding or will get lost in the crowd. So really you want to stand out, do something outstanding, be a leader, not have any group identity, and do something which is very important. Very important thing is that some people make and others break. This is because of their commitment. They don't mind failures. The repetitions are very important. I give you the best example to my student. The day when you come to medical college and you go to canteen, you look at the menu card. Second day, you'll remember it. Canteen is a place you like to go more times in the classes, isn't it like that? And you'll remember the menu card by heart. After a few weeks, you need not to look at the menu card of your canteen, and you'll by heart you'll remember, order everything. This is because of the repetition, which puts an imprint in your mind. When you go to a top 5-star hotel once in 6 months or on your birthdays, you need to scroll through all the menu card because you don't remember, you've not been repeating the visits here. And that's the beauty when you study. When you study, you retain something. When you repeat it, you retain another 20 minutes. You read and write, you retain another 20%. You read, write, and speak, you retain another 20%. So repetitions are very important in medical education, so you retain, and this is a very important thing we should do about it. The difference lies in our attitude. This is very important. It is well said, success depends 10% on what happens, but 90% success depends upon how do we react. Our attitude of reaction decides whether it will succeed or not succeed. I must share with you, some people never get upset that someone is doing top or someone is doing next top. Both the intelligence is only 10%. 90% is a diligence. Hence, everyone has a standard genotype which can be converted into best of the phenotype. Only thing is that diligence, sincerity has to be done. Second issue is that a consistency for few hours a day is enough. 24 hours are too long to behind this. When I qualified civil services, I was doing first year residency. Whole day I used to read medicine, and there was so shortage of time, what do? I taped history and geology notes in 400 cassettes. So after I'm very tired slogging in the ward, I'll put on, that time there used to be Walkmans. I'll put the cassette in the Walkman. One evening I'm hearing French Revolution, the other day evening I'm hearing Russian Revolution, third day German Revolution. So once I was on duty, in duty room, listening to my French Revolution, so one of my colleagues came, oh, good music, give me. And the moment he changed the headphone, he said, no, I don't want it. So that's the scene, you need to be very hardworking and you need to be there. What makes a winner? Take constant battle being waged within you. In our heart, there's a constant battle, and there are two walls sitting in our heart. One is an evil wall, which is greedy, which is arrogant, selfish and egoist. And other warmth we have in our heart, which is peaceful, calm, happy and gracious. Now, everyone, all of us have two thoughts, two streams, two walls sitting in our heart, which is one is a greedy and arrogant, other is a peaceful and calm. And if you ask me, which is going to win in my case, it all depends which warmth you feel. If you are cool, composed, and just ignore the other aspect, you are going to have the peaceful, the gracious war. If you feed the irritable, the egoist war is going to be egoist. So your choice is what you feed, which is very important. So be very positive in life, overcome vices that pull you down, and strengthen the goods that take you up. So always make an algebraic sum, and it is very important. Always remember, no course is bad or no course is good. No person is better than you. Everyone is most dignified. When you go to a cobbler, you look for the best cobbler. When you go to a pawn shop, you look for the best pawn shop. When you go for a plumber, you look for the best plumber. So everyone best in his field, you need to have the highest level of self-dignity and self-compose and compassion to do your profession most gracefully. Good intentions with bad action is a common practice. Now the biggest challenge with our today students are good intention with bad practice. We have positive intentions, but the bad practice, WhatsApp keeps you busy, the friends keep you busy, the birthday party gives you, the practice is bad. So you need to be very supportive to what your good intentions are. This is very important. Better insight to do is easy, quick, and convenient. Don't opt for an easy, quick, and convenient passage. Always rather than try to choose the best and the consistent way. So don't try to adopt the shortcut. All of you have a positive intention, the best intentions, but our practices are wrong and we need to correct the practices slightly. Thinking, believing, and knowing what is good is okay. Thinking, believing, and knowing what is good is okay, but not ultimate. Doing is ultimate. So you need to be very careful about it, and that's very important. Here is an attitude. You have to have a very positive attitude, the problem-solving attitude, not finding a problem-aggravating attitude, which is very important, and ability to see and smell an opportunity in every problem is very important. You should, every difficult situation, every problem, you should be able to find some opportunity, some good thing. I'll give you the recent example. A month before, one of my residents came, "Sir, I'm quitting. I'm upset, I'm tired, I'm exhausted. No seniors cooperate with me. I'm round the clock. I've not gone home for 3 days. I said, "Okay." He was in fuming. He was very upset. I let him cool down. Then which whole unit of ours in faculty, I asked him a few questions. I said, "You are with us for how many years?" He said, three months. For how long you are with us? He said, 3 months. I said, "I'll ask you 10 situations. You saved acute MI, you saved left ventricular failure, you manage children with diabetic ketoacidosis. These are the few things you have been managing alone." "Yes, sir, I'm managing alone." I said, "Tell me, the day when you joined our wards, did you know anything of these two handle?" "Okay, no, sir, I did not do anything. I was very shaky, I didn't do anything. And now in the span of 3 months, sir, I can handle everything." I said, "You should thank God, count your blessings at the cost of your physical stress and strain, at the cost of your personal and family life, you have gained what you didn't know 3 months before." When I made him to realize, count his blessings, he totally changed, and I think now I'm finding him smiling, talking, and very happy about it. So what I would suggest is that all of you will have some tough times in your life, difficult times in your life, same with me also, but I stay so happy. The moment you have tough times in life, start counting your blessings. I give an example. I count blessings that I know Dr. P.D. Patil so well. This is also a blessing to me. So start counting your blessings, all good things, bad things, your relations, your blessings of parents. But I would have never come back to India if my father would have not wanted me to come and be with him. I would have always be abroad. So you count the blessings that whenever you are in a blues, whenever you are difficult, always remember, start counting your blessings that today I've done this good job. I've taken a good history of a patient. I've known this disease better than before. This is all your blessings. So start counting your blessings and you'll never be in the lowest pitch of your life, which is very important. And there's a saying in English, eye sees what mind knows. The one of the prerequisites that you should be well read. I give the best example. A early diagnosis is more important. If you're well-read, you will make an early diagnosis, early interpretation. I give the best example when I take classes. A four-year-old child goes to take him to a zoo, and four-year-old child sees a lion. He sees four legs, two eyes, a tail, roar of a lion, and he can, next time you take a four-year-old child, he will say, oh, here is a lion. So reading a book is like seeing a lion in a cage. Seeing a patient is like seeing a lion in safari or jungle. You go to jungle in an open jeep, you see the footmarks of a lion, you hear the roar of a lion, you're not seeing him. With a binocular, you see the tail of a lion, and you sense that there is some lion around, let us protect ourselves. If you wait, let the lion come, let me confirm, four legs, 2 ears, the tail, the roar, by the time he comes and kill you. So when you become a professional of excellence, you develop such traits that pick up a disease so early, with the earliest sign, earliest symptom, earliest sensitivity, that you don't wait for complications to happen. And this can happen only if you are well-read. Eye sees what mind knows. So that you need to be well-read, you need to be well-aware, and apply those, your readings, with the help of your teacher on the patient. Let me tell you one thing. Teachers are the one, they'll be happiest possible if any of the undergraduates or postgraduates or people come and ask you some question. This is the happiest moment that, yes, I need to help them out, which is very important. Now, this is very important. The philosophy of the ant, you know, that you need to be non-stop working person. You need to be determined. You know the story of ant? No one knows. Ant is so small. It works relentlessly. You create an obstruction in the passage of the ant, what will it do? It will change its route and find a longer route and go to its destination. Look at the work and the pleasure management of ant. That in summers, ant works, picks up the food, stores in a hole where it relaxes in the winters and hibernates for the energy. This happens like that. Ant is so small, but it works, takes the volumes of the food material, the stuff, much bigger than her weight. So work relentlessly, work hard, and work undisturbed. Never be swayed by anything losses in the life, which is very there. Ants are purpose driven. They are so purpose driven, so focused, that they look for their food and they look for their mates. They are never drifted away. So you should also be purpose driven. God has given you 24 hours. Devote few hours every day for the purpose given. Rest is all you to enjoy. If you work professionally, sincerely, academically, you enjoy the leisure also much harder. So if you look at this, the philosophy of ant can be concluded in terms of all the students that hardworking, very hardworking, relentlessly she works, purpose driven. She is purpose driven. She carries the food particle in the stores for the winters. She is farsighted. She knows that after summers, they are not going to get the food, so they store it. They don't quit. Even if you stop, you block the way, they don't quit. Even if you have some rough patch in your college, or you have some issues in your exams, never get disturbed. You will get it. They maintain work-life balance. Look at here. She saves the food for the winters. Hence, achievers look for solution in every problem rather than problem in every solution, which is very important. Your priority should be brilliant, academically well-read, but at the same time, I must submit to all the younger children, same I tell to my children, that you need to be full of virtue, you need to be full of humility, you need to be full of respect, you need to be full of dignity. It is very important to be humble and good human being. Not swayed by materialistic comfort and materialistic world. I again repeat, excellence in education doesn't make you complete human being. You need to be humble and humiliating. I must share with you, Jaipur is a place of jewelers. We have often international jewelry shows. Recently there was an international jewelry show and they asked me to write an article for a jewelry magazine. Very difficult. I was resisting. I said, what do I write for jewelry magazine? Then what happened? Okay, I said, fine. I wrote the article, and the article mentioned laughter the best medicine. And I gave an example. You go to a jewelry shop, you find a lady who comes out of a Porsche car, loaded with the jewelry, possible the nicest branded cloths, best of the purses, which I know they are very precious these days, the best of the sandals. People keep looking at her, but unfortunately very gloomy, non-communicative, no exchange of pleasantries, and very snobbish, and very cornered one, except that she has a very impressive profile to look at this. You enter the jewelry show, you find the second lady with the simple cotton cloths, loaded with the artificial jewelry, bubbling with the happiness, greets you, talks to you, laughs to you, enjoys you, talks very nicely and humbly, receives you, takes you all around. Now, whom would you like to be friend with? The first one or the second one? And the general answer was the second one. So always remember, the material comforts and the material things doesn't matter. What you are, your character, your humility, your dignity, and your strengths are more important. And I'm sure all of you like to be more friend with the second lady than the first lady. And I think that's a very strong to give a message. I must tell you again, the pedigree of a horse is judged by not his fancy stable. Pedigree of your horse is not judged by a fancy stable. It is judged by breeding and the training which is imparted to horse. So you need to be full of virtues, full of good human being, and full of dignity, which is very important. A person with knowledge cannot be stopped. Person without knowledge cannot be held. Knowledgeable person is always likable. Knowledgeable person is always respected. This is all what we talked about, the basics. But let me tell you one thing. Ours is a very profession which keeps you very busy. Which you share the pain and suffering of others. It keeps you little in low profile. So there has to be humor also in our life, which is very important. And sometimes it is very important to have a humor. A very wise old teacher once said, I consider a day's teaching wasted if we don't all have one hearty laugh. So our profession has to be very colorful and hearty laugh. Injecting humor and an element of ludicrous is almost of utmost importance. We should always be humor in our life. I ask this room full of academicians, all teachers who are sitting, don't you all relish a little bit of humor once a while, which is very important. Don't forget that teacher is a performer as well as he has to engage his students with his personality, his conversation and his action. Much beyond the teaching, he has to converse well with them. If you cannot interact with your pupil, you cannot certainly empower them. More you interact, more you can empower. And sense of humor is one of the best weapons in the armory of teacher. I still remember one of the final year students goes to a non-medical statistician. Tells him, please define what is the statistics. He says, being a non-medical, the statistics is very simple, science of mean, mode, median. He says, give me some good example. Doctors are a little weak in statistics. So he says, give me some good example. He realizing, let me impress upon my medical friend that I also know some medicine. He said, look, it is a science of mean, mode, median. If you put head of a person in oven and legs into refrigerator, on an average, body is in comfortable position. This was an impression of a non-medical person. He tried to impress upon a medical person. It is important for doctors to teach future doctors the value of wit and humor. Bedside manner is an art in itself. And no amount of degrees or specialization can substitute the comfort and ease that a doctor can give to his patients. This is very important. There's a difference between your qualification and bedside manners, and hence you need to excel in bedside manners also, because you are torch bearer of your institute. Added to humor is a quality of compassion that all future doctors must inculcate. A warm smile is better than many bitter medications. Having stressed the significance of humor, I will tackle the most serious aspect of being teacher. Although there are no tried and tested formula for successful teaching, more so in a medical profession, but we can always try and set some rules and parameters. The rule number one, for especially medical teachers, to stop teaching. Yes, I don't mean truly the stop teaching. If you are going to stand and regurgitate facts, remember that Google can do better. When I say I stop teaching, I just go and regurgitate the facts that Google can do better than me. If teachers are simply going to be fact providers, they will soon become extinct. So teachers have to be much beyond than fact providers, otherwise they will have the extinct like dinosaurs. They will have their fate like dinosaurs. Do not be on the stage, but rather a meddler in the middle, a guide by side. Acknowledge the harsh truth that these days boys and girls are more exposed, intelligent and techno-savvy. You and I cannot match. Hence, we need to interact with them, be very practical and interact more and more rather than simple wriggling out the facts, which is very common. And that's the reason we need to change the pattern of the teaching, more interactive and more the practical oriented. So the best we can do is to facilitate, ignite the spark, and then stoke the fire of curiosity. This will also teach our students to be responsible for their own learning and be lifelong learners. The rule two is that, remember that several minds are always smarter than one. The shared pool of knowledge in any field will always be greater than individual's personal knowledge. Hence, follow the modern mantra of collaboration and cooperation. When you plan lectures, do it collaboratively. When you hand out tasks and projects, encourage teamwork. Added benefits here is that the student learns to acknowledge and respect different perspectives, while at the same time adding width and depth to existing knowledge. So more of the interactive and more of things should happen. You know, in a medical profession, doctors are so preoccupied, they forget their own priorities. One postgraduate didn't realize what he's writing on the preface of his thesis. He dedicated his thesis to his my most beautiful, charming, affectionate, loving wife. He tried to give all credit to her. He didn't realize in his preoccupation of the work, I dedicate to my most charming, affectionate, loving wife. Because of her, I'm doing it now. Otherwise, I could have done it long back. So that's the reason. The same gentleman was so preoccupied that after getting married to the same beloved, he left for honeymoon. And in the flight, they barely managed to catch the flight because he was busy in his chamber, she was busy in chamber, they rushed to the airport. In flight, the wife remembered, my dear husband, I kept the iron on. I fear the house may catch fire. Husband said, cool, relax. I believe I kept the shower on, so it will take care. So doctors, they have no time for their own personal things. They're too busy with their preoccupations. Last but not least, teach a student that internet might be their best friend, but can also be their worst enemy. You need to be very careful. Everything that they read on web is not the gospel truth. This is very important in medical profession. And they must learn to filter the available information to separate the grain from the chaff. You have to separate the grain from the chaff. Most importantly, teach your student to be ethically upright. If they borrow knowledge, they must learn to give credit and cite to the source, which is very important in medical profession. This moral fiber that you inculcate in medical students will hold them in the good stand as a doctors when they will face the ethical dilemmas in the later profession. I must give a final message to all my dear students that prerequisite to be a good human being is an ample of knowledge. But along with the ample of knowledge, couple up your personality with utmost humility, utmost respect for others, utmost self-dignity, and the greatest respect for teacher of your institute and your institute which has brought laurels to you. It is your institute and teacher. You are staying here in such a wonderful institute that this is turning your genotype into phenotype. What you are on day one you came to Divine Patil and what you are on the day you part away from Divine Patil. So never forget to pay the respect, demand, dignity and humility, all the acknowledgement to the institute which you have come to. I live with the profound words. And finally, as all the teachers who are there, बिन गुरु नहीं होता जीवन साकार जब हो गुरु की अनुकंपा अपार तभी बनता जीवन का सही आकार गुरु ही सफल शिष्य का है आधार सो ऑलवेज रिमेंबर डियर स्टूडेंट्स दैट योर इन्वॉल्वमेंट इज योर एक्सलेंस इन एकेडमिक्स बट कपल अप विथ योर ह्यूमिलिटी डिग्निटी रेस्पेक्ट फॉर एवरीवन अराउंड एंड ऑलवेज पे योर रेस्पेक्ट इन रिगार्ड्स एंड एक्नॉलेज द टीचर्स एंड द इंस्टीट्यूट विच ब्रॉट लॉरेंस टू यू विच टर्न a genotype of yours into phenotypes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for that inspiring speech. I request our Director of Academics, Dr. N.J. Pawar, sir, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable Chancellor of Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth, respected Dr. P.D. Patil, chief guest of today's function, and renowned physician and diabetologist, Dr. Sudhir Bhandari, honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth, Professor Rajdan, Registrar of the University, fellow officers, deans of various faculties, my dear teachers and students. At the outset, let me wish you all very happy Teachers' Day. On this particular occasion, we have had a wonderful talk by honorable chief guest, Dr. Sudhir Bhandari. I am indeed very happy, sir, to have you with us today, this particular morning, on the occasion of Teachers' Day. Your address was very pertinent to this particular occasion, and I am sure that apart from the professional education that we have always been imparting to our students, I'm sure the message that is given by you in terms of compassion and values of humility will be certainly penetrating into the class of all the students and the teachers that we have here. Certainly, we were really benefited by your talk. We look forward for your further suggestions and advice from time to time. And we'll certainly see the occasions wherever it is possible for you to come and again enlighten our students and teachers. Thank you on the behalf of Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth. Friends, today is an occasion where all the teachers and students are here. Our respected Chancellor Dr. P.D. Patil is with us. In fact, for the first time that I have had an opportunity wherein he opened up his mind, although little less, but he opened up his mind. I understand the pain, difficulties, and difficult times through which he has gone in terms of shaping the future of this particular institute. Sir, we are all very thankful to you for gracing this particular occasion and addressing the gathering here. Honorable Vice Chancellor of Dr. D.Y. Patil Medical University is with us today for this particular one. He has already given you insight on several different aspects of teaching, learning, job of a teacher and student, and relationship between the two. I remember guru of all the gurus and teacher of all the teachers, Dr. Swami Vivekananda. He once said, knowledge comes from within. There's no creator of a knowledge, but knowledge comes from within. And he further says that knowing is unveiling. It means that that is where job of all the teachers is involved. Unveiling is a job of teacher, because teacher is a motivator, inspirer, guide, philosopher, any number of adjectives we use in terms of describing a teacher. Friends, we have felicitated today a large number of teachers, those who have excelled in research as well as teaching learning programs. I take this opportunity on behalf of you all to congratulate all those teachers. I also wish them all the success in future. Some of the students, because students and teachers, they are inseparable entities. Because of students, teachers exist, and because of teachers, students actually progress. And therefore, these are inseparable entities, and therefore, I also take this opportunity of congratulating all the students who have excelled, topped their classes, and also wish them all the success on this particular occasion. Once again, I take this opportunity of thanking you all for gracing this particular occasion. Look forward for further sharing of our experiences and expectations in future too. Thank you very much.
I request all to rise for our national anthem.
पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंग विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्छल जलधि तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गारे तव जय गाता।
Students and the dignitaries to kindly join for the refreshments arranged outside.